A year ago, I was reviewing the first generation of Threadripper released by AMD, and in particular the 1950X, which, by the way, you should be watching right away if you haven't done so yet. And it was, of course, a tectonic change in the workstation industry, and AMD took swaths of market space from Intel. It was really a statement from AMD saying, hey, you know, we're not on the passenger seat anymore. And of course, AMD is trying to repeat its miraculous feat and further contribute to the market with its second generation of Threadripper. And today in particular, we will be reviewing the 2990WX, the most impressive and expensive of them. I mean, we are talking about 32 physical cores, 64 threaded, 80 megabyte of combined cache memory. I mean, what the? Now, just a friendly warning, if you're here only for my looks, yeah, you want to go somewhere else, because this is about to get pretty geeky. Without any further ado, roll that intro. All right, so let me start by saying that there is a lot to talk about, and I'm gonna try to cover this as fast as I can. I did compare the processor to a few other. I tried to keep it on a short list, and I compared it to the 2950X, which is 2 grades lower than the Threadripper 2990WX. And I also compared it to the equivalent Intel processor, which is in our case, the i9-7980XE. So that said, let me cover a couple of pragmatic points. First, you will not need to upgrade your motherboard for second generation Threadripper, which is pretty cool. So if you already have your X399 motherboard, such as I do, then you simply have to update the BIOS and boom, you're done. So no new motherboard, no new cooler, no new casing. That's already a massive positive point. Now, price-wise, we are talking about a processor which will run you $1,800 before tax. That's not something everyone can afford. I'll talk about that later, but that will buy you the most powerfully specced processor. And I'm saying powerfully specced because there are limitations I want to cover later. CPU on the market. We're talking about 32 physical core, 64 threads, 83 megabyte of L1, L2, and L3 combined cache, a base clock at 3 gigahertz with a turbo mode of 4.2. Great overclocking opportunity, by the way. And well, more than 19.5 billion transistors. In comparison, the Intel i9-7980XE comes with only 18 cores and 36 threads, 24.75 megabytes of L1, L2, L3 combined cache with a base clock of 2.6 gigahertz and a turbo mode of 4.2 gigahertz. And transistor wise, I mean, Intel does not ever release how many transistors there are in their processors. But I mean, the best guess is that there's no more than 7 billion transistors. But does it show in real life performances? Well, I've run Cinebench R15, and of course, the Threadripper exploded the i9-7980XE, and same for Blender's 2.9. And I'll say this, those are the usual benchmark that people use, but as you know, I love going out of the sentier and get a little bit crazy. So I've tried crypto mining. I've tried CPU crypto mining with Monero, and I've used the latest version of JCE, and I'll add some details on my blog on how I configured it. But out of the box, without any overclocking, the 2990WX gave me 2.4 kilosol. That is crazy. So we're talking about a processor which is extremely profitable when it comes to direct hashing, pure computing power. So yeah, very exciting about that, because you know, some people could argue that you can pay back your processor after a year of mining, which was exactly what AMD argued for the first generation 1950X. But again, it's a dangerous bet, and we will discuss about power usage, but this is not your everyday processor, and we'll see that at the end of this review. Talking about overclocking, the processor seemed to be pretty stable and very flexible with different speeds, but for me the sweet spot was about 3.8 gigahertz, so that's 800 gigahertz over the base clock, with, you know, you have to give some liberty on the wattage, because this is a processor which is rated to use anywhere between 200 and 300 watt loosely, but when you do overclock it, I have noticed obscene amounts of wattage. I've seen a stable intake of 600 watts. 600 watts, that is more than three video cards. And I saw some peaks going around 800 watts. So I got really uncomfortable looking at my processor taking that much electricity. And I was even afraid of seeing it burn. And actually, it's not only a feeling, because AMD has precisely said that they will not cover any damage linked to overclocking. I do not know how they're going to verify or enforce this, but yeah, even if you use their proprietary software, which allows you to overclock and tweak things on the processor, if you damage it, you're not covered by warranty. And I'm not very happy about this, because I really think this is kind of a move from AMD, but it's also something that's not very enforceable, because, you know, if you buy it from Amazon and it's burned, then you just return it and Amazon's not gonna give you any problems, or Best Buy or what have you. You know, wherever you're gonna buy it, if there's any problem, return it. Either it's gonna be replaced or refunded. So yeah, I think AMD should have been more pragmatic and say, hey, anyways, it's fine, you know, what have you. But more than anything else, it does send a message that this processor has weaknesses when it comes to power consumption and heat, so you really have to watch it. All right, so gaming-wise, well, I'm feeling weird testing a $2,000 on games. Of course it's going to outperform anything you're gonna throw at it. Of course, 32 cores, come on. There is no doubt about this. I don't wanna waste your time. I don't wanna waste my time. So you know what? Let's cut it a day and assume that this is the very best gaming processor in the world. All right, I hope you liked this video. Like it if you liked it. Don't like it if you don't forget to subscribe. Good try, yeah. Well, gaming-wise, I was surprised, and not automatically in a good way. I have tried a couple of different engines, and therefore I went directly onto Doom and Wolfenstein New Colossus, as well as Resident Evil 7. And you know, that's where things stop making sense for me, because I've tested the 1950X last year on the same games, and I had a crazy amount of frames per second. And if you remember, Doom was performing at about 200 FPS, if not more, stable. As far as Wolfenstein New Colossus, also it was absolutely crazy. But here, if you look at performances metric, both the 1950X, the 2950X, and the i9-7980XE outperformed our 2990WX, and that didn't make any sense to me. And it's not just an impression, that was not just a blip of one video game. Every video game I tried gave me the very same result. It was underperforming, and I didn't really know why. I was even wondering if I did something wrong, if the drivers were not correctly installed, or if I had, you know, all the software running at the same time in the background. But everything became clear when I did some Adobe Premiere rendering. What we've benchmarked so far are all single task or very focused task application. And there is no surprise in the fact that given the number of transistors and given the number of cores, this thing's gonna destroy its competition in this field. But as soon as you go on multitasking and memory intensive tasks, everything is different. But what is going on here is that this processor, the 2990WX in particular, is a retail version of AMD EPYC processor. And what that entails is that it's not made to be run on a quad-channel memory motherboard. The EPYC usually run on 8, on octo channels. And that changes everything, because when you have 32 physical cores and you only have 4 memory channel, some of the 32 cores will not get any memory to feed them. So yeah, some of the cores choke off, they are starved or thirst out of memory because there's only 4 channels for 32 cores. You would need at least 6 or 8 channels so that you can dedicate memory everywhere in the same time. And it doesn't really matter that this processor can support up to 1 terabyte of RAM as long as it's stuck into a 4-channel configuration. And the best comparison I can make is if you had 4 guys and 1 bottle of water. You know, when one of the guys drinking the water, the 3 others don't, and they're waiting. It doesn't matter how big the water is, even if it's a 10,000 liter bottle of water, there's still only 1 mouth and 1 bottle. What you would need is 4 bottles for all of them to drink in the same time. And that's what's going on. So when you're running video games, when you're running memory intensive tasks, some of the cores are idled and waiting for the core before it to complete its memory task. And that is surprising to say the least, because AMD knew they were getting into with this. And you know, I'm a big fan of AMD, but it's not that it's a design flaw. It's just that it's not even rushed. I think it's kind of a marketing move. I mean, because if you look at the 2950X, it doesn't do this at all. There is only 16 cores on a quad channel. All the cores are getting as much memory as it need. They're not bottleneck like in the 2990WX. And you know, that was the right way forward, but they absolutely wanted to have a 32 cores on the market. So to make a big bang, and it kind of did work. I mean, that's what I bought, but I'm surprised to say the least. Now, there is a way through the master software that AMD has released to go in what they call legacy mode. And the legacy mode effectively shuts down cores. So you can shut half of the cores down, or even 3/4. So you can have a 2990WX running only on 8 physical core or 16 physical cores. And as expected, as soon as you go in half legacy mode and shut down 16 of the physical cores, then your processor is breathing again. There is plenty of memory for all the cores and it starts to perform like a 2950WX. It doesn't outperform it, but it performs just like it. But the other side of the legacy mode is that if you do put it on, when it comes back to mining or pure processing, you will lose half of the performances. Remember, mining in Monero, instead of 2400, you'll be at about 1,200 sol per second. But even though you have the legacy mode, I cannot see people turning it on and off depending on which software they're gonna use. I mean, it's just not feasible. So yeah, it's a cool trick, but not a lasting trick for an $1,800 processor. So the best you can do here is to know its limitation, know what you wanna use it for, and accept that. All right, so I don't want to give the wrong idea. This is probably the best data cruncher in the world for retail computers. I really mean this. It will do data rendering like none other out there right now. But as soon as you go on multitasking or memory intensive tasks such as video gaming, and things are a little bit different. And it's a great gamer, but it doesn't do it as well as cheaper processors such as a 1950X or the 2950X. It just doesn't. So if you're looking for video gaming, I'd really suggest you go on those options, because the 2950X is $900 cheaper and the 1950X is now about $700. So those are real good opportunities for both doing some rendering and crunching data and have amazing video gaming performances. And as for the i9-7980XE, it simply is a grossly overpriced processor. It barely outperforms the Threadripper 2950X, which costs no more than $900. For my daily usage, I'm gonna go for the 2950X and I'm gonna let go the WX. Again, great processor, but maybe too early, too many cores. What you want to do, if I had one advice to AMD, is to revisit this and to not be afraid of getting a triple channel memory with six models of RAM or even octa one. I know the motherboard will be more expensive and it'll be more expensive to populate all those RAM channels, but hey, you know, if you're gonna release a watered down EPYC processor, because that's what it is, it's an EPYC architecture processor, then that's what you should be coupling it with.